Welcome to Let's Talk Humanitarian, Parlons Humanitaire, enriching conversations with humanitarian workers and leaders from all over the globe to open eyes, heart, and mind. This program is offered to you by Kalu Institute, your online center for humanitarian aid studies, where humanitarians train humanitarians. My name is Amelie Yanguifesa, and I'm really honored to be your host for this program today with Alvaro De Vicente, the head of regional office for Latin America and the Caribbean of ECHO. Hi, Vicente. Nice to have you online.
Hello, Amelie. How are you?
Thank you very much for your time. Thank you for being here with us with Kalu Institute, and I'm looking forward to our conversation. Let me introduce you in few sentences. All this rich experience, almost more than 25 years, no?
Yeah.
Experience, yes, more than 25 years, yeah.
Yeah, now that you say it, yes, it's true. I was counting, 1, 2, 3, yes.
Yes, wow, fabulous. So you started as a university teacher in the University of Guatemala.
Yes, in fact, that in Spain, when I was young, we were obliged to do the military service. But we haven't. At that moment, we had the option of doing what we call the objeción social, objeción de conciencia. So in order just to do a social service instead of military service. Okay. And in this frame, I was sent to the University of Quetzaltenango in Guatemala, and I was teaching there. For a year.
Wow, beautiful. And then you engage with the Action Contre la Faim?
So no, I thought,
Action Against Hunger.
Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
It was after the year in Guatemala, in which I was also working as a volunteer for a local NGO that was called Agua del Pueblo.
Okay.
That day I got in touch with all these water and sanitation and in cooperation projects and ideas, and then I was recruited by Acción Contra el Hambre, Acción Contra la Faim.
So the Spanish one, or you worked with the Spanish one, the French one?
I started with the Spanish one. I was recruited by the Spanish one. Then I was sent to Angola, and then I came back, and then I left to Mozambique with the French part. And I have been working with the French, between the French and the Spanish branch of ICF for 10 years.
Excellent. Wow. Yes. Amazing. So your specialty is water and sanitation. You're an industrial engineer. And then you specialize in water technologies, no?
Exactly. I'm an industrial engineer. And then I started working for the technical side of the water and sanitation side. So I started by calculating distribution networks, size of the tanks, all these very engineering issues. And then I started studying precisely, water technologies and management with the University of Salamanca. And then I became, and then I worked many years as a specialist in water sanitation and hygiene, and then I became head of office with ECHO, and now as I'm a humanitarian generalist, I don't cover only water sanitation and hygiene, but all sectors, as you can imagine.
Okay, so and then after Action Contre la Faim, Action Against Hunger, 15 years with ECHO.
Yes, 15 years. Yeah. The time
that's
really quick, flies. Yes.
So with ECHO, you've been in Bangkok, in the regional office, located in Bangkok, so covering Asia and the Pacific. Then as a head of office for Ecuador.
Yes.
Yes, mm-hmm. And now you are the head of the regional office. Based in Panama, you've just opened the office there, no?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I've been already for 12 years in this region, in Latin America and the Caribbean. So I started as the head of office for South America in Quito, in Ecuador, after I was the head of office for in Colombia, in Bogota. And now, for a bit more than 1 year, I'm based in Panama. I opened the new regional office for Latin America and the Caribbean that is now based in Panama. Yeah.
Okay.
This is my current role now. My current
role. Perfect. So thank you so much, and that's going to be really interesting because we really want to ask you so many things about. Actually, my first question would be for in this region of Latin America and the Caribbean, what would you say are the main humanitarian issues today in 2021?
Okay, I think that we have to take into consideration the particularities of this region. Okay, because when you see from outside, it can be sometimes a bit weird to realize how many humanitarian issues are here. No, the first one is if we take into consideration the risk, the humanitarian risk. If we look at the vulnerabilities, capacities, and hazards. First of all, when we see at the hazards, we need to realize that this is the region, the second region worldwide affected by natural hazards in terms of number of deaths and different indicators. So you have all kinds of hazards, as you know. This is the most violent region in the world. Okay. Hmm. If you take the list of the 10 most dangerous cities in the world, probably 8 or 9 between among these 10 in the world are in Latin America and the Caribbean. So this is something also to consider. Okay. So we are talking about man-made crisis and also natural hazards. Okay. And if we talk about capacities, I think that sometimes we have the possibility at the humanitarian side to do things that elsewhere are a bit difficult to do because the capacities of civil protections here or the institutions that are working for the victims of conflict and like this. This means that sometimes when you are working for humanitarian issues in other regions, you get a bit disappointed at the end because there's nothing sustainable. But here, sometimes when you manage to set up something and that is going to be sustainable in the time, and you can just let some communities or institutions prepare it. Okay, so this is as a general scope of the region. After, concerning the part of the question of what are the main issues today, well, we know that we have, if we go from north to south, Mexico and Central America, we have a flow of migrants and displaced people going from Central America to the United States in difficult conditions. In sometimes some occasions we are talking about forced displacement, and this is also fed by the food security crisis that is provoked by the harsh situation in the dry corridor of Central America. So we have first of all the humanitarian impact of food insecurity and violence in Central America and Mexico. Okay, this is the first one. Mm-hmm. Second one is in the Caribbean, we have Haiti, that is a protracted crisis in which the situation has become more critical recently with the political tensions, with the food insecurity and everything. So now we have new protection threats for all population with gangs, etc. So this is also a complex crisis that is happening now. Obviously, we have the Venezuelan crisis that now is probably the one that is attracting more attention internationally. That is a huge one because we have a crisis in which we have millions, probably more than 10 million people with humanitarian needs inside Venezuela, but more than 5 million Venezuelans that have fled from the country in more than 17 countries in the region and with humanitarian needs. So this is a huge regional crisis, but also inside Venezuela we have a huge problem there. After probably we can enter more into the details of this crisis. And in South America, we have the conflict in Colombia that continues going on. And people think that because of this, is the train passing now? So probably. I need to stop because probably. is the Panama Canal train that is going from the Pacific to the Atlantic and is passing just close to the office. So it's okay. For the Colombia, as you know, despite the peace agreement that was signed in 2016, the situation has got worse, and now we have a real problem of violence armed actors that are affecting vulnerable communities in the coast of the Pacific coast of Colombia, inside Colombia. And so this is a problem that is, despite the fact that many people think that the conflict in Colombia is over, this is not true. We have severe humanitarian consequences also. So these are, let's say, at the point of view of the different crises, the main files that are our priority for us, and also related to natural hazards. We are still responding to the Eta and Iota hurricanes that happened in Honduras, Nicaragua, and Guatemala at the end of last year. So this is also a response that is ongoing. Okay. And we have also the situation with COVID-19, because COVID-19, you have to think that Latin America and the Caribbean is the region worldwide that has been most affected, both in terms of health. Now you see the figures in Brazil are going at the top the worldwide, but also in terms of impact on livelihoods and food security, because with you, as you can imagine, with more than 10 million people displaced in the region, these people in situation, in vulnerable situation, migrants are particularly affected by COVID-19, because it's almost always that they are excluded from social protection systems in the countries, in the host countries. And in general, they are depending from the informal works, informal jobs. So they are basically with no job and ideas. So we have cases of eviction and a particular situation with this migrants and displaced concerning this COVID-19, with borders that are closed. So all the people that are crossing from one side to the other of the border is basically irregularly. If you do it irregularly, basically you don't have any right, you don't have any identification. So basically you are in a vulnerable situation. And the other part is also the indigenous communities in South America, which are particularly affected by COVID-19. In places where the access to health care facilities is really limited. So this is another issue to consider.
Okay, thank you very much, Alvaro, for this humanitarian presentation of the main issues. And would you say you've spent already 7 years in this region? Have you seen any trend or any evolution?
Yes, the let's say the humanitarian map of the region has completely shifted from 7 years ago to now. Why? If you see what we were funding from ECHO in the region 7 years ago, it was mostly disaster preparedness actions. Okay. Uh-huh. And based on this disaster preparedness, we were also providing support in case of disaster. Okay. So this was the case, for example, of Haiti earthquake or the floods in Peru or whatever. So basically the main shift or the main strategy in the region was basically to reinforce the capacities to respond to natural hazards, with the exception of Colombia conflict, in which we were already working. We have been working from the starting from 1994, but it was an exception, the response to conflict. Okay, so most of our budget was devoted to preparedness and response to natural hazards. Today the situation has completely shifted, because we are mostly working with complex crises. We have the crisis in Central America and Mexico, with all this displacement of people and people being a victim of violence. Mm-hmm. We have the Venezuelan mega crisis, which is affecting the whole region. And we have the Colombian conflict that is ongoing, together with Haiti. So now today, we can see that most of our budget is devoted to complex crises and non-natural hazards. And it does not mean that natural hazards have stopped.
Yeah,
it means
no,
that now we have another layer of problems, and a huge one. So today, we can see that Latin America is a serious concern in humanitarian terms. It's a serious concern because we have crisis ongoing, and the capacities that we have with the high price of commodities at the beginning of the century, it was relatively well off the situation, and some middle income countries were going up. But now, with this new complex crisis, and together with COVID-19 and IDs, the situation has dropped, and now we have this situation is critical for many sectors of the population.
Quite worrying trend. And would you say then that the funding has increased, or you having challenges to mobilize more funds also because of all the situation, the refugee crisis in Europe, the COVID, etc.? Or how has been funding wise?
The funding wise, we have increased because the average budget of for this region coming from ECHO, it was at around between 30 and 40 million euro per year. And in 2020, we had 140 million euro at the end of the year. So we have tripled the regular budget that we had. So, but even like this, I would say that it's still not enough. It means in terms of percentage of what ECHO is contributing in terms of percentage compared with the requests. I think that we should still increase our funding because this is still a drip in the ocean for some crises, as for example, the Venezuelan crisis.
Thank you so much, Alvaro. And could you tell us a little, what is ECHO exactly? What does that stand for? Because we know what we call sometimes the EU embassy or delegation, then there is ECHO. Can you just clarify a little what is this European entities that we find?
Okay, good. So ECHO, in fact, the acronym originally, as you know, it was a European Commission Humanitarian Office. Okay, mm-hmm. It was a simple name for a simple structure at that time.
Now, which was 20 years back, no?
It was in 92. Yeah. Okay, now the situation has evolved, the institution has become more complex, and the name also now is about the. It means basically we are the Director General now today for civil protection and humanitarian aid operations. Okay, so. This means that you know that in the European Union we have, in the European Commission, we have Directorate General, that is the same as it can be for a government to have the ministries. Okay, so we have Directorate Generals, we have for financial, for trade, for development, etc. And so we have one in the European Commission that is civil protection and humanitarian aid operations. So this is, let's say, yes, one directorate inside the European Commission. We have many in the European Union of that, but as we are, ECHO is supposed to act and to implement activities depending on the humanitarian principles. One of these humanitarian principles is independence. So we cannot be, our action should not be oriented by politics, by interests. It should be guided by needs. Because it's the aid that should be provided impartially, neutrally, with independence, and obviously with humanity. So it's because of this that we are independent from other parts. We are not included. If you see in the different countries, we have the European Union delegations, that they are a sort of embassies that are including the political affairs, the trade, the culture of Europe, the political representation. But We have offices that are independent because we are not responding to this interest or whatever. We are responding to humanitarian needs, and that's why we need to be independent. In many countries, the ECHO offices are included in the EU delegations, but these are countries in which the humanitarian is not sensitive. Mm-hmm. It's not, for example, if you are in a country in which we have just natural hazards that are affecting and you need to work and to respond, this is not conflictual. You are going to work hand in hand with the government and to provide assistance, to prepare the local civil protection and whatever. But in other countries in which there are this political sensitivity, for example, the Colombian conflict, or this in which there can be some linkages, political linkages with the humanitarian response, in this case, we have separate offices, okay? So that's the way. So ECHO is basically, we are funding NGOs, UN agencies, Red Cross. We are not implemented by ourselves, in principle. We are just funding the as you know, ECHO, we call ECHO partners that are in the field. And our work as ECHO is to follow up the humanitarian situation in order to be able to assess better what are the priorities that we should fund in each region, in each crisis. Also, to know and to get in contact with our partners in the field, because it's the way of knowing what are their capacities, the specialties, the skills, and like this. And also because the reflection about the strategic reflection with them has to be done together. And also to monitor this project means that when we are funding, we are selecting. So we make part of the selection when we receive project proposals. we're supposed to evaluate what is the quality of the proposals, the assessment ideas, and the capacity of the partners so that we select together with our headquarters what are the best projects to be funded. Once they have been funded, our responsibility is to monitor them. What does it mean to monitor them? Well, to visit them, to verify that the indicators that they have written are properly followed, are properly achieved, to follow up that the budgets are expended, that they are respecting the policy, their policies and our policies in terms of gender, resilience, food security, etc. So in order to be sure that everything is spent on that. So this is a responsibility because this is money from taxpayers in Europe that is being spent by our partners, and this is our responsibility to go and to support this. So that's basically this. There is an independence, as I mentioned before, from other tools of the European Union, and it can be IDPA, that is the previous DEFCO, that has changed the name, and this is development assistance. We are supposed to be independent, but at the same time, the European Union also has a role to play in contributing to the resolution of the problems. It means, as humanitarian, we are not providing solutions, we are providing relief. But mm-hmm. with the advocacy that is done by delegations or with the development assistance that is provided by IMPA, DEFCO, they can just put their support to provide solutions. It means that somehow we need to be linked also, independent but linked, because when we finish, and if there's a problem, for example, in Central America, in Guatemala, about food insecurity, the solution is not going to come from providing food assistance and distribution of cash for the people. The solution is going to come with proper policies and with development planning of these communities. And this, in this sense, the EU can provide assistance, and they are doing so. So we need to be linked somehow in order to ensure that what the assistance we are provided is also supported by a contribution to the resolution of the problem.
Okay, excellent. So that would be a little, so I understand, looking at the root causes and addressing the root causes and also creating the possibility of sustainability, you know, that you
exactly.
actually was a clear added value that you found in the region. And is it that what we call Nexus?
Yeah, exactly. This is what we call Nexus, that has been named by different names along the story, as you know, the LLRD, resilience, whatever. But now the fancy word is Nexus. And then is where we put together what we call the triple Nexus, that is the humanitarian assistance, but at the same time we have the development support that is coming to provide either a continuity to what we have funded, either more structural interventions in order just to provide the base for the resolution of the problem, okay? And after we have also the political, what we call the peace building, that is somehow, for example, an example could be Colombia. In Colombia, the European Union was the main partner contributing to the peace agreement. So while ECHO was providing humanitarian assistance to the victims of the conflict, the EU delegation was supporting the peace agreement in order to solve, to try to not to solve because they were not going to solve, because but to contribute to the resolution of a problem that is the conflict as such. Hmm. Obviously, if this problem, the conflict and the peace was real, obviously we don't have any role to play the humanitarian because the problem is solved. So obviously this, you know, these three legs nexus that is fundamental for contributing towards the same objective, that is, okay, no more humanitarian needs at the end.
Thank you so much, Álvaro, for this perspective. So you introduced us the humanitarian challenges, issues, and definitely you explain us as how ECHO is addressing the humanitarian needs in the region. But what would you say for 2021 are the main focus thematically wise and geographically wise in the region for ECHO?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so ECHO is positioned in all the main humanitarian crises in the region, as I mentioned before. So we are talking about Central America and Mexico. So there is, we are focused on providing support to the victims of violence and people under displacement from the whole corridor from Central America through Mexico to the States. Okay, and also providing support to the families that are victims of their food insecurity. Okay, and somehow they are interlinked. We have also in Central America contributing to the disaster preparedness, that for the first time, or now also for a few years, you know that traditionally the ECHO support in disaster preparedness was focused on natural disasters. But now is, let's say we are more strategic and we are providing the DP budget line is focused on reinforcing the capacities, the local capacities to respond to whatever is the crisis, being violence, being complex crisis, being, so this makes us being much more strategic and to have a consolidation of this. And this is interesting because while we are responding to a crisis, we have the option of using our DP strategy to build the capacities to respond to this crisis. And this is fundamental. The other one is Haiti also, because Haiti, the situation continues to deteriorate. And there is a challenge to focus our response because we are talking with about more than 4 million people in need of humanitarian assistance. That's a lot for our budget. So we need to be focused and to try to, how are we going to target, how are we going to prioritize our action in order to be sure that this is making the difference. Okay. So this is the other issue. For the Venezuelan crisis, our priority is inside the country rather than outside, because there we have been the main donor inside the country from the beginning in Venezuela through the access that we have been working from 2014, and we feel that our added value is more in this aspect. So from the 42 million that are now in the initial budget that we have for Venezuelan crisis, around 55-60% of it is to Venezuela, inside Venezuela. Okay? Yeah. And our priority there is mainly the border areas which is crossed by migrants and displaced that are crossing there, and also peri-urban areas in which the situation is becoming really, really bad with the collapsing structures in terms of health, water and sanitation, protection. We are talking about a country that is under collapse, so we have a problem that is an immense humanitarian problematic. And obviously, for the migrants and displaced people, our focus is mainly, because we are humanitarian responders, we recognize that there is a long-term problem for the host countries. We are talking, for example, Colombia is hosting almost 2 million Venezuelans in their territory. But many of them are there for already more than a year, more than 6 months. We are focusing on the people that is in transit, because our budget is limited and we need to focus on the most immediate needs. No? And probably you know that people from Caracas are walking for thousands of kilometers by walk because they don't have the means to pay a ticket for the bus or whatever. So the situation in which they are crossing, they are arriving even to Lima, to Santiago by walk. You can imagine these thousands of kilometers with no proper shoes, with no proper clothing, without access to food. And in some cases, they are sending everything they have. They have sometimes a mobile phone or something like this. They send it in order to have access to food, and finally they have basically nothing to complete the way. So this is a critical situation that we're trying to tackle, and obviously it seems that it can appear that 42 million euros is a lot, but the RMRP, so the regional plan that has been defined by the platform, is $1.4 billion dollars for it. So it's a minimum part of it. Our contribution is really, really small. So we are all the time fighting to have to raise the visibility of this crisis and to try to attract more funding, because this is desperately needed. The other is Colombia, because Colombia conflict has a low visibility, continues to be what we call a forgotten crisis, because nobody realized that we have people being displaced and under a situation of need because of this conflict, but this is going on. And our responsibility is also to raise visibility, to do advocacy, and to provide funding to these people, these victims that are still being affected. And we have to think, look, that in Venezuela, Colombia is a country that is crossed by Venezuelan displaced people. So we have many cases in which Venezuelans are trapped in this conflict, are attacked by armed groups. Venezuelan children are being recruited by armed actors, armed groups, in Colombia, because they are in a desperate situation. So young, the people 15 years old, obviously they have nothing, they are desperate, and they are recruited by this armed group, either for drug trafficking, for information, for carrying out weapons and whatever. So this is also the protection problem that we are facing in this case of this humanitarian mess between Venezuela and Chile on this corridor is terrible, and the protection problem with a number of unaccompanied children is extremely high. If we compare, according to some of our partners, the percentage of families that are becoming disaggregated or separated because of this migration is 5 times higher than in Syria. So this is a drama that is ongoing, and we need to raise the visibility to have this experience. And after, and last but not least, we have the indigenous problematic in South America. This is a structural problem. We all know that indigenous are suffering from deforestation and different violations of rights perpetrated either by states, either by private sector or whatever. And in general, we cannot say that this is a humanitarian problematic, but in this case, yes, it can have some humanitarian consequences. And this is what we are trying to now to dig a bit to see what's going on, because with COVID-19, we have seen the situation of affectation from indigenous populations whose organizations are requesting humanitarian assistance because they are in desperate situation with the pandemic. They don't have access to prevention and control materials and equipment. They don't have access to health. And in our strategies, I mean, for the future, for 2022 and forward, I would say that is some of our strategic objectives to dig, to try to see what's going on in the Amazonian, in the Gran Chaco also, in which we have humanitarian consequences of deforestation, of forest fires, of human rights violations. And this is also one of our priorities.
Well, thank you, Alvaro. The truth is that, yes, it's so important to hear that from you. The intensity of the crisis and the diversity of the crisis in the region, and and unfortunately the increase of the humanitarian needs, and who would you say are the other donors who are working with ECHO and in the region on humanitarian issues?
Okay, here the main humanitarian donor is United States. The United States and their agencies are the main in terms of funding and presence. Okay, you can see that, for example, for the RMRP, for the regional plan for refugees and migrants coming from Venezuela, 70% of the funds last year were allocated by USA. So it's massive, and it makes a difference with others, no? So they are either through USAID or FDA, either through BPRM, what they call now the BHA. This is the main donor by large, because this is the region somehow, okay? There are also the Spain, who is present, not in terms of volume, but in terms of presence. Yes, they have a presence, a humanitarian response, even if limited, but they are working also in Central America, in Colombia, Venezuela, and like this. And they are also present. And some other EU members of the European Union, as Germany, for example, they have a relatively consistent contribution to the Venezuelan crisis. Sweden also, they are present. And Switzerland, COSUDE, what we call here, if they are little by little just closing, but they are still important in their assistance to development and humanitarian assistance.
Thank you so much, Alvaro, for sharing all this information, giving us some insights on what is the role of a donor in the middle of so many crises, and it gives us a precious update on how things are going in Latin America and the Caribbean. To finish this this interview, I would like to ask you two more personal questions. Have you ever dreamt or considered doing something else than humanitarian aid?
Many things, right?
Yes.
First of all, in fact, I am very happy and I'm incredibly satisfied with the work I do and my humanitarian, but it was never a dream because I didn't know what was humanitarian assistance before doing it. Uh-huh. It was, as I mentioned before, it was just in my way. And I found it and I thought, oh, wow, this is good. I would like to do this, but it was not I suppose, for example, for my daughter, she dreams of being humanitarian. And she's looking at the job, the work I'm doing and like this. And since just realizing before arriving, leaving a school, what she wants to know, to do. It was not my case. I was an engineer. I was working like this, and I was doing calculations in a computer. And a day in Guatemala, a technician from the field told me, "Do you want to see what you are calculating in reality?" And then I accompanied him. And when I saw the results of my calculations in the field with these children taking the water from the source, then I realized this. Okay, I want to do this the rest of my life. So that's why, how it became a dream, but just by doing it. No, in terms of profession of work, no. Well, I could. I have many hobbies. I'm a singer. I play guitar, and I like to do woodworking. Probably, and sometimes when I'm too stressed with the work, I dream of being in my village, just working my wood and doing my furniture. Because it's something I like to do, but nothing beyond that.
Okay, thank you. As you know, this program is watched by the students of but many students of Kalu Institute. With all this experience, this 25 years of experience that you have, what would be the advice you would like to give to all these students on our master in humanitarian aid and international cooperation? The one piece of advice.
I would say, probably be curious all the time. Why? Because I think that probably today, with the tools we have, with the Kalu, for example, the education that is provided by Kalu, whatever, you have already the tools, the guidance and like this, but what will make the difference for you would be the what you are going to listen from the people, you are saying, what you are going to talk with them. So be curious, discuss, ask. Because this is what is going to make the difference and to help you taking the appropriate decision at every time. Because when you are going to arrive to a country with your books of humanitarian assistance, food security, etc., under your arm, okay, you are going to probably to feel that you have all the tools, but no, you need to discuss the people, you need to listen, you need to know what's going on, because every country and every crisis is different. And a friend was saying all the time, the only thing you know about the next crisis is that it will be different to everything you expect.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Alvaro de Vicente. This was an interview. You were talking to us from Panama. Alvaro de Vicente is the head of the regional office for Latin America and the Caribbean for ECO. Thank you for your time, your insights, your inspiration. You have a lot on your plate, and we wish you the best of success, if we can use this word in reaching out to those in need. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.